Well, I'm here to talk about the container runtime security with Falco. How many of you are running some kind of container environment in production? And almost, I hope, almost all of you are running some kind of security solution? Not really? Yes? No? Ah. OK. First things first, I'm that guy. And I love to say several things about me. The first and the most important one is that I'm daddy of twins. And that basically means two things. The first one is that I barely can sleep by the night. So, so you know, I usually tend to forget things and repeat things and so on. And the second one is that probably I'm one of the most patient people in the world. because the same reason. So if you are out there and see me, you can talk with me, chat, and so on, or write some emails. That's my Twitter handle. You can contact me without any kind of problems. I promise I'm going to go back to you. And on the other hand, the technical part is that I'm a Kubernetes member. I am the author of the Helm charts for Sysdig and for Falco. Also the same for the operators. I wrote the two operators from Sysdig. And the last couple of things is about the GevCTL capture plugin. It's just a plugin when you are having troubles in your cluster, for example, some kind of class loop backup, and you want to debug what's happening inside the container, you can use a plugin to capture, to take, imagine some kind of movie or photo too, of all the activity that is happening in the container, so that you can dig a little deeper to know the root cause about that. And the second one is about an announcement that we will do, hopefully in a couple of 2 or 3 days, is the Security Hub platform. I will show you later. Second, this is the agenda. This is the stuff that we are going to talk today. The first one is just an introduction to container runtime security. The second one is about Falco and how we can use Falco. The third one is about what is a Falco rule, how can I write a Falco rule. And the last one is the active security, is a demo about a response engine we built on top of Falco and in Kubernetes, so that when you receive a security threat, automatically you can trigger several actions to protect the cluster automatically. I mean, if you detect, for example, if you detect that someone is writing something in a container, you can just kick the container. This not solves the problem, but you gain more time to answer the threat. So runtime security. I love to start my presentations with the security slide. Oh, thank you. The first one, if you read some kind, every book you read about security, it starts, or even if you read the networks book from Tannenbaum, the security chapter has these principles to establish a security strategy. The first one is about the trust boundaries. It's not the same to secure a development environment or an staging one than a production one. You need to have different policies for everyone. For every environment. The second one is about reducing the hardened attacks. Perhaps this is a principle, and if we talk more concrete about this, is about if you know that you don't need any kind of packet, please don't install it. I mean, the Vim editor has several vulnerabilities that allows code execution, or even if you just are developing an HTTP API, why you should include an FTP server on that container. You don't install anything that you don't know. The next one is about the scope and access, you know, the password and so on. Finally, I want to recall the two latest one is about the layer protections. On every layer in your application, in your platform, you have several security mechanisms. And we will talk later about that. And finally, is the traceability about all the things that you are doing, especially when you are suffering, when you are having a security attack. Because sometimes we are under pressure, we try to think and react fast, and sometimes we are causing more harm than the benefit that we are getting just typing commands and looking for the root cause. But these principles apply, are still active, are still vigilant, but the container changed several rules in the game. The first one, I love the first statement because it's really a marketing sentence. That means, basically, many security paradigms are still reactive. That means that until we don't get an attack, we don't start to consider security. And finally, at the end, all of us are going to be attacked. So the sooner you start to think about the strategy attack, is the better. Because you shouldn't take some decisions in just after attack. If you want to start a change, it's a different way. I remember the days when I started to write code with TBS or Subversion, that if you want to introduce Git in your organization, Git or Mercurial and so on, you need to stop to sit and wait until a backup breaks. And then, we can use a distributed solution and so on. The next one is about as long as that we don't have enough tools inside the container. That means that we are really used to ship all our application in an Alpine container and so on. And then it's just the application, because we don't want to install more things than needed to broaden the attack surface. And okay, this is a point, but we don't have enough tools inside the container. The next one is about that you can, that sometimes you didn't notice about an attack in several months or weeks or days or so on. You can be attacked and you never notice about it, because there are some reasons about that. And finally, the two ones is about the abuse attacks. The nature of attacks are changing. It's about some kind of infrastructure abuse instead of that exfiltration. Perhaps most of you remembers about the Ashley Madison attack and all the database exfiltration with all the emails, phone, and so on. I remember I joined SysDig about 1 year, 1 year and 7 months, and so on. And I remember one of the first things I saw in SysDig was when we are starting to productize secure. And I remember a fork that created a Kubernetes cluster just using Eptio conformation stack, when Eptio was Eptio, and had a really nice setup about Kubernetes on AWS. And then the stuff that happened is that next month, the guy received a bill from Amazon for about $25,000 of infrastructure. That what happened here. Then the problem that was that he received an attack, then the attacker get access to the Kubernetes API with the token and started to spawn pods with cryptominer stuff. You know, mining Bitcoin is hard, it's a kind of expensive, but if you do with others' money, it's okay, not so expensive at all. So you can do it. So this is the abuse activity. And finally, I reordered this one. It's about the ephemeral nature of the containers. That means that sometimes you almost don't need to remove your steps. I mean, usually if you see some kind of malware or rootkit or so on, most of them try to shred the bash history or remove the track of what happened inside of that. With the container is gone. And I want to show you this graph. You can see it. In this graph, last week we published the container usage report about our customers on SysDig, and we found the lifespan about a container in just running is, in this case, about less of 30 minutes in a 7,300% 73% of time. I know most of the containers that our customers are using are living for less than 30 minutes. That means that you can't, in the classical way, we were used to take a snapshot of the of the snapshot of the files in the way that just doing some MD5 integrity checks on the files, but just on 30 minutes, we don't have time to use the same strategy because the container has gone. We can't use the same strategy. And finally, this is the sketch we published, it was several months ago, about the different layers of security we can have on Kubernetes. The first one, you know, the host secrets, the host security is that using minimal images, you are used to core OS or distros like that. You also have the admission controller to avoid or to control what is going to be run into the cluster. Also, you have the image scanning part that is going to report you the images that contain known vulnerabilities. It's so important, this part. And also, you have things like the well-known bug about Kubernetes. And I think it's not present. Yeah, the network policy. We were used also to, you know, almost all of us knows about firewalls. But when you are running a Kubernetes cluster, you don't know when a pod is going to be run. So you need a different approach. I mean, you don't know which one is the IP addresses for the pod who can connect to another part. You need just a higher level of abstraction for doing that. And finally, if I have to summarize all of the content of my talk here, I just want to capture your attention here that image scanning is necessary, but it's not enough to ensure, to guarantee the security in your cluster. That means we were used to think about that container are immutable, and yes, the container images are immutable, but the running container per se, I mean, the image is immutable, but the container is not immutable. You have several operational drift, like sometimes sys log files. You can have different inputs that can modify your system, your running system. But yes, the image is immutable, but the runtime environment can change. So the next question is about, well, this is pretty cool, but how we can detect abnormal behavior in our container setup. So we have, I think it's not, well, in the police slide, I'm pretty sure that you can see this in a bigger way. I want to recall this part that images are immutable, but containers are not. You can have several problems with privilege escalation that you can't detect on image building. I mean, when you are building the image, you also can have problems with the new zero days attack. Once the zero day attack is public, it's okay. You can detect it using image scanning, but in the first day, probably not. And several things like you know, the social part of your company, of your organization is the weakest one. You can be rough, someone can steal your password, some people still are using POSI to write the passwords and put it in the table. So there are parts that you can have a strong security strategy, but there are people that sometimes or doesn't follow the procedure, or the procedure is too complex, and so on. And then we are going to change the way to detect. We were used to detect harmful behavior, and we are going to do just using the plain system calls that are happening in the container. I mean, we are pretty used to terms like big data and so on. How many system calls are happening in a host while you are running? It depends of the host, of its workload, and so on. But we have a ton of data, a lot of data, to infer several behaviors like someone is trying to open a file. Imagine that someone is making an open call to write something under your bin directory or under your sbin directory, or is trying to read the etc shadow. Why you are trying to read this right now? You are trying to steal some password. What are you doing that? And the other part is about the Kubernetes audit log. We have the units, and we need to start to thinking about the orchestrator. I mean, we can detect with the audit log things like if someone is trying to put an empty, a plain password in a config map instead of using a secret. You know, a secret is a base64, but you can give more security to a secret to change the implementation. But the proper way is to use a secret and not a config map. Or if someone is trying to spawn a pod in the cluster, we can detect that with the audit log. And finally, we need to put all the inputs in some kind of brain. I don't want to tell machine learning because we about 6 or 8 months we started to do some machine learning and the profiling is starting to work, but the first experiments were pretty hard and not so good results. And finally, detect the attack, make some rules, let that Falco run the rules, also the several security standards, and finally, if something goes wrong, just send a notification in a plenty of ways. I mean, so this is the thing about Falco. Falco is a behavioral activity monitor. That means that Falco is going to detect some kind of suspicious or some kind of abnormal behavior inside your container, based on several rules. Here is the place where I put also several rules, security hub. The point here is that Falco is able to see what's happening inside a container. If you are used to the kernel terminology, you know that a container is just a process with namespaces and C groups. But it's just a process that we can see what's happening inside. If you go to FreeBSD, in their jails or the zones of Solaris, the implementation is different. But in the case of Linux, we can see what's happening inside the process. And we can see it's opened, or the ASAP, or listen, or all the system calls that is happening. And finally, we can just choose the its notification methods, choosing for a variety of files, standard output. In the new version of Falco, there's a gRPC output plugin, so on. And finally, the good point about this is that this is open source. It's a Kubernetes sandbox product, and please, most of you can contribute if you wish. It's C++, but they are okay. But there are some parts that are being written, the new parts are written in Go. The Falco CTL and new tools are written in Go. And this is more or less how Falco works. In this part, we have finally a kernel module or an eBPF proof that sources all the system calls that are treated by a sysdig libraries. You can see sysdig in this part, some kind of WireShark. Most of you knows about WireShark, the network analyzer. Well, it's a network tool that captures all the traffic. It's pretty the same, but instead of the network traffic, just with all the system calls that are happening inside the host. Hey, look. Okay, then we have a filter expression, a rules engine, and well, when the system call matches the event, we raise an alert. Is that the point? We also have a web server that is able to ingest the audit logs from Kubernetes. So, you know, every time the two previous versions, they introduced the audit log. So every operation that you do against the IP server is going to be logged. So we can know what's happening inside the cluster. And the good point, the thing I love to see about this, is that you have your application, your company application, your organization application. You can have Nginx or so on. Everything, every piece of open source that you use in your deployment. And finally, you deploy Falco as a daemon set in your Kubernetes cluster. And just using kernel technology, we can know what's happening inside. That means that you don't need to use ptrace for tracing of the libraries. The ptrace is the technology behind strace that or the debuggers or so on. That is a bit slow in usually for knowing several things. Or other people tries to do this just preloading the libc so that they can intercept the system calls. In this case, it's just kernel technology. And if you don't want the kernel, you can use the ABPF proof that is guaranteed that it's only read only. And sometimes this looks like a kind of magic, and this is just system calls. The theory of operating systems is just behind all of this. The Falco rules. I love to show the rules, and because nobody is going to contribute their rules right from the right from scratch, because most of you are not used to do this kind of rules. So we created. We have several rules, like you know, the Python and the batteries included mantra. So we Falco already ships rules that helps with the container best practices. Someone is trying to spawn a cell in your container, or someone is trying to write something about something in your binary directory, and so on. And also, here we have Security Hub. I'm going to show you. Change my screen. Here, this is the container uses report, and here is the Security Hub where you can find several rules to secure Apache, console, if you are using PHP, if you have a Rails deployment, you can just, if you are using help, just secure Redis with one command, or if you prefer, you can just download the rule we craft for you. This part is also open source, and you can contribute. Here, just issuing a pull request. And finally, the last part is about that security incidents can be a pretty stress can force you to have a bad time. I mean, you are going under attack, you are going to have stress. It's not the best time to think. Or to take some decisions, and we need to the action plans are consistent, are focused, and are repeatable, and that's the point we built our response engine on top of Kubernetes. I'm going to show you a demo because we are running out of time, and I here in this cluster, here I have NATs in this place, here I have kubeless that is running just two functions, a function to delete another for isolate, and just Falco with a sidecar which sends the alert to NATs. And then I configure this just with Helm, and I enable the NATs output, and just deploying the two playbooks. So when I run, kubectl sect. Going to suppose that I gain access to the Nginx deployment, and then I can run the update apt install cool. Yes, please. Cool. If I call to Google, but I configure right here that if someone tries to write on a binary there, I'm going to isolate him, google.com, touch, bin, foo. If I call Google again, he's in a trap. He cannot go out. But there's one thing more, that in this case, if I write on root, touch, foo, the container disappears. I didn't solve. The problem is not solved, but I just gained some time for that. So this is a engine to automate the security reactions just using Falco and Kubernetes technology. And if Google didn't troll me, thank you for coming. If you have some question, I will be happy to answer. Oh, thank you.
We'll be right back.